Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents Venture Deals, 4th Edition. Be Smarter Than Your Lawyer and Venture Capitalist by Brad Feld and Jason Mendelson. Narrated by Barry Abrams. Forward by Fred Wilson, 3rd Edition. I remember the first week of my career as a VC. I was 25 years old, it was 1986, and I had just landed a summer job in a venture capital firm. I was working for three experienced venture capitalists in a small firm called Euclid Partners, where I ended up spending the first 10 years of my VC career. One of those three partners, Bliss McCrum, poked his head into my office. Yes, I had an office in Rockefeller Center at age 25, and said to me, "Can you model out a financing for XYZ company at $9 million pre-money, raising $3 million, with an unissued option pool of 10%, and then went back to the big office in the rear he shared with the other founding partner, Milton Pappas. I sat at my desk and started thinking about the request. I understood the raising $3 million bit. I thought I could figure out the unissued option pool of 10% bit, but what the hell was pre-money? I had never heard that term. This was almost a decade before Netscape and internet search, and so that wasn't an option. So, after spending about 10 minutes getting up the courage, I walked back to that big office, poked my head in, and said to Bliss, "Can you explain pre-money to me?" Thus began my 31-year education in venture capital that is still going on as I write this. The venture capital business was a cottage industry back in 1985, with club deals and a language all of its own. A cynic would say it was designed this way to be opaque to everyone other than the VCs, so that they would have all the leverage in negotiations with entrepreneurs. I don't entirely buy that narrative. I think the VC business grew up in a few small offices in Boston, New York, and San Francisco, and the dozens, maybe as many as 100, of main participants, along with their lawyers, came up with structures that made sense to them. Then they developed a shorthand so that they could communicate among themselves. But whatever the genesis story was, the language of venture deals is foreign to many and remains opaque and confusing to this day. This works to the advantage of industry insiders and to the disadvantage of those who are new to startups and venture capital. In the early 2000s, after I wound down my first venture capital firm, Flatiron Partners, and before we started Union Square Ventures, I started blogging. One of my goals with my ABC blog at www.avc.com was to bring transparency to this opaque world that I had been inhabiting for almost 20 years. I was joined in this blogging thing by a friend and frequent co-investor, Brad Feld. Club investing has not gone away, and that's a good thing. By reading ABC and Feld thoughts regularly, an entrepreneur could get up to speed on startups and venture capital. Brad and I got a tremendous amount of positive feedback on our efforts to bring transparency to the venture capital business, so we kept doing it. And now, if you search for something like participating preferred, you will find posts written by both me and Brad on that first search results page. Brad and his partner Jason Mendelson, a recovering startup lawyer turned VC, took things a step further and wrote a book called Venture Deals back in 2011. It has turned into a classic and is now on its third edition. If Venture Deals had been around in 1985, I would not have had to admit to Bliss that I had no idea what pre-money meant. If there is a guidebook to navigating the mysterious and confusing language of venture capital and venture capital financing structures, it is Venture Deals. Anyone interested in startups, entrepreneurship, angel, and venture capital financings should do themselves a favor and listen to it. Fred Wilson, USV Partner, July 2016. Forward by James Park, 3rd edition. I remember the first time I saw the exit sign for Sand Hill Road off of Highway 280. It was 1999. I was 22 years old, had just dropped out of Harvard, and was the co-founder and CTO of a startup based in Boston. My co-founder and I decided to cast the net wide in our search for money and flew out to Silicon Valley to meet with VCs. As I saw the exit for Sand Hill Road, I started to feel incredibly nervous and unwell. I immediately noticed the telltale signs of a distinct lack of preparation and knowledge. I felt this way if I hadn't studied thoroughly for a test in school. In high school, right before a cross-country race, I felt this way if I hadn't put in enough miles of running in practice. By this time, hadn't I learned my lesson about preparation and its effect on my digestive system? Why did I show up to such important meetings so uninformed about the people and the industry from whom I was trying to raise money? Well, in 1999, it wasn't so easy for a 22-year-old first-time entrepreneur to figure all of this out. We did succeed in raising money for that startup, but due to our own mistakes and the tough environment at the time, we ended up closing our doors a couple of years later. However, I made a couple great friends, Eric and Gokhan, from that startup, and we picked ourselves up and immediately started another company called Wind Up Labs. After 4 years of incredibly hard work, we sold Wind Up to CNET Networks, now part of CBS Interactive, in 2005. And as part of the acquisition, we all moved to San Francisco. In 2007, Eric and I left CNET to start Fitbit. Honestly, Eric and I started off with fairly modest ambitions for the company, but as the years passed, our ambitions grew. From 2007 to today, the company grew to over 1,500 employees, and our most recent guidance to investors called for approximately $2.5 billion in revenue in 2016. We raised over $66 million in private capital from VCs, including Brad and Jason at Foundry Group. In 2015, Fitbit went public, raising over $800 million in the biggest ever consumer electronics initial public offering, IPO, in history. I've remained its CEO from founding to today. As I read this book, I was amazed at how succinctly it captured the sum of my 16 years of experience raising money and dealing and working with VCs and corporate lawyers. I wish I could travel back in time and hand this book off to my nervous and ill 22-year-old self, along with an iPhone and the idea for Facebook. You, the listener, have gotten a huge bargain. After finishing this book, you will have skipped years of painful experience, trial and error, and learning on the clock from expensive lawyers. This is literally the business book equivalent of Neo jacking in and learning Kung Fu in an instant in The Matrix. As you find yourself driving down 280, or depending on how long this forward lasts, being whisked in your autonomous electric car, and the sign for Sand Hill Road comes into view, feel confident that you've been prepared the best you can with advice from some of the best VCs I know. James Park, Fitbit co-founder and CEO, July 2016. Foreword by Dick Costolo, first and second editions. I wish I'd had this book when I started my first company. At the time, I didn't know preferred stock from chicken stock, and thought a right of first refusal was something that applied to the NFL waiver wire. Today, as the CEO of Twitter and the founder of three previous companies, the latter two acquired by public companies and the first acquired by a private company, I've learned many of the concepts and lessons in this book the hard way. While I had some great investors and advisors along the way, I still had to figure out all the tricks, traps, and nuances on my own. My partners and I in our first company, Burning Door Networked Media, were novices, so we made a lot of mistakes. But we managed to sell the company in 1996 for enough money to keep ourselves knee-deep in Starbucks tall coffees every morning for a year. Several years later, my partners at Burning Door and I started a new company called Spy On It. This company did better and was sold to a public company called 724 Solutions in September 2000. Our stock was tied up for a year. We weren't that tuned in to registration rights at the time, and when we got our hands on the stock in mid-September 2001, the collapse of the internet bubble and the financial aftermath of 9/11 had caused our stock to decline to the point that it was worth enough money to keep us knee-deep in tall skim lattes at Starbucks every morning for a year. So, like all good entrepreneurs, we tried again. This time, armed with a lot more knowledge and humility, we started FeedBurner in 2004. We raised several rounds of venture capital, including a seed round from DFJ Portage, a Series A round from Mobius Venture Capital, the firm Brad Feld and Jason Mendelson were part of at the time, and Sutter Hill, and a Series B round from Union Square Ventures. FeedBurner grew quickly, and before we knew it, we had attracted acquisition interest from several companies, including Google, which purchased us in 2007 and allowed me to stop using coffee purchase analogies to quantify the payout. After spending several years at Google, I was recruited to join Twitter, where I am now the CEO. During my tenure with the company, Twitter has grown dramatically, from 50 people to more than 430 people, and has completed two major rounds of financing, having raised over $250 million. When I reflect back on what I know now about VC deals, acquisitions, how VCs work, and how to negotiate, it's very satisfying to see how far I've come from that day back in the early 1990s when I co-founded Burning Door Networked Media. When I read through this book, I kept thinking over and over, where were you when I started out? As the knowledge contained between these covers would have saved me a remarkable amount of time and money on my journey. Brad and Jason have written a book that is hugely important for any aspiring entrepreneurs, students, and first-time entrepreneurs. But it's not just limited to them. As I read through it, I found new pearls of wisdom that even with all the experience I have today, I can put to good use. And if you are a VC or aspire to be a VC, get in the front of the line to hear this to make sure you are armed with a full range of understanding of the dynamics of your business. Finally, if you are a lawyer who does these deals for a living, do yourself a favor and listen to this also, if only to be armed with things to use to torture your adversaries. Dick Costolo, Twitter CEO, March 2011. Preface. One of the ways to finance a company is to raise venture capital. While only a small percentage of companies raise venture capital, many of the great technology companies that have been created, including Google, Apple, Cisco Systems, Yahoo, Netscape, Sun Microsystems, Compaq, Digital Equipment Corporation, and America Online, raised venture capital early in their lives. Some of today's most significant entrepreneurial companies, such as Facebook, Twitter, Airbnb, LinkedIn, and Uber, were also recipients of venture capital. Over the past 25 years, we've been involved in hundreds of venture capital financings. About 15 years ago, after a particularly challenging financing, we decided to write a series of blog posts to demystify the venture capital financing process. The result was the Term Sheet series on Brad's blog, www.feld.com/archives/category/term-sheet, which was the inspiration for this book. As each new generation of entrepreneurs emerges, there is a renewed interest in how venture capital deals come together. We encounter many of these first-time entrepreneurs through our activities as venture capitalists at our firm, Foundry Group, www.foundrygroup.com, as well as our involvement in TechStars, www.techstars.com. We were regularly reminded that there was no definitive guide to venture capital deals and decided to create one. In addition to describing venture capital deals in depth, we have tried to create context around the players, the deal dynamics, and how venture capital funds work. We have tossed in a section on negotiation, if only to provide another viewpoint into how venture capitalists, at least the two of us, might think about negotiation. We also took on the task of explaining the other term sheet that fortunate entrepreneurs will encounter, namely, the letter of intent to acquire your company. With each subsequent edition of the book, we have added sections on alternative forms of financing, including convertible notes, crowdfunding, and initial coin offerings. Most recently, we've added sections on hiring a lawyer and an investment banker, as well as a detailed section on raising venture debt. We have tried to take a balanced view between the entrepreneur's perspective and the venture capitalist's perspective. As early-stage investors, we know we are biased toward an early-stage perspective, but we try to provide context that will apply to any financing stage. We also try to make fun of lawyers any chance we get. We hope you find this book useful in your quest to create a great company. Audience. When we first conceived this book, we planned to aim it at first-time entrepreneurs. We both have a long history of funding and working with first-time entrepreneurs, and often learn more from them than they learn from us. Through our involvement in TechStars, we have heard a wide range of questions about financings and venture capital from first-time entrepreneurs. We have tried to do a comprehensive job of addressing those questions in this book. As we wrote the book, we realized it was also useful for experienced entrepreneurs. A number of the entrepreneurs who read early drafts or heard about what we were writing gave us the feedback that they wished a book like this had existed when they were starting their first company. When we asked the question, "Would this be useful for you today?" many said, "Yes, absolutely." Several sections, including those on negotiation and how venture capital funds work, were inspired by long dinner conversations with experienced entrepreneurs who told us that we had to write this stuff down, either on our blog or in a book. Well, here it is. Before one becomes a first-time entrepreneur, one is often an aspiring entrepreneur. This book is equally relevant for the aspiring entrepreneur of any age. If you are in school and interested in entrepreneurship, whether in business school, law school, an undergraduate program, high school, or an advanced degree program, you will benefit from this book. We have each taught many classes on various topics covered in this book, and hope it becomes standard reading for any class on entrepreneurship. We were once inexperienced investors. We learned mostly by paying attention to more experienced investors, as well as actively engaging in deals. We hope this book becomes another tool in the tool chest for any aspiring investor, whether an angel investor or venture capitalist. While we have aimed this book at entrepreneurs and investors, we hope that even lawyers will benefit from us putting these thoughts down in one place. At the minimum, we hope they recommend the book to their less experienced colleagues so that we can all speak a similar language around venture deals. Finally, unintended beneficiaries of this book are the significant others of investors, lawyers, and entrepreneurs, especially those entrepreneurs actively involved in a deal. While our wives are quick to say, "Everything I've learned about venture came from overhearing your phone calls," we hope your life partner can dip into this book every now and then. This can be especially useful when an entrepreneur needs some spousal empathy while complaining about how a venture capitalist is forcing a participating preferred upon them. Overview of the contents. We begin with a brief history of the venture capital term sheet and a discussion of the different parties who participate in venture capital transactions. Following this is a section on preparing for fundraising and choosing the right lawyer. We then discuss how to raise money from a venture capitalist, including determining how much money an entrepreneur should raise. This includes a section on how to properly prepare your company for fundraising and discusses the materials you will need before hitting the fundraising trail. As part of this, we explore the process that many venture capitalists follow to decide which companies to fund. We then dive deeply into the particular terms that are included in venture capital term sheets. We have separated this topic into three chapters: terms related to economics, terms related to control, and all of the other terms. We strive to give a balanced view of the particular terms along with strategies for getting to a fair deal. Following the chapters on terms, we discuss how convertible debt works and the pros and cons versus raising equity. We next cover several alternative forms of fundraising, including product, equity, and token crowdfunding, and how they differ from traditional venture capital deals. This is followed by a detailed section on venture debt. We then go into a frank discussion about how venture capital firms operate, including how venture capitalists are motivated and compensated. We discuss how these structural realities can impact a company's chance of getting funded or could impact the relationship between the venture capitalist, her firm, and the entrepreneur after the investment is made. Since the process of funding involves a lot of negotiation, the book contains a primer on negotiating and how particular strategies may work better or worse in the venture capital world. We attempt to help the entrepreneur learn ways to consummate a transaction in a venture capital financing while avoiding common mistakes and pitfalls. Since there is no such thing as a standard venture capital financing, we cover different issues to consider that depend on the stage of financing a company is raising. We discuss some of the theories behind why any of these documents even exist so that you can understand the hidden incentives in the process. As a bonus, we've tossed in a chapter about the other important term sheet that entrepreneurs need to know about, the letter of intent to acquire your company. We include a section on how and when to hire an investment banker to help you sell your company. Finally, we end with a section on why term sheets even exist in the first place, along with tips concerning several common legal issues that many startups face. While it's not a dissertation on everything an entrepreneur needs to know, we've tried to include a few important things that we think entrepreneurs should pay attention to. Throughout the book, we've enlisted a close friend and longtime entrepreneur, Matt Blumberg, the CEO of ReturnPath, to add his perspective. Whenever you hear a sidebar titled "The Entrepreneur's Perspective," these are comments from Matt on the previous section. Additional materials. Along with this book, we have created some additional materials that you may want to review, including resources for use of this book in a classroom. These materials are all on the Venture Deals website at www.venturedeals.com, referred to in previous editions as the Ask the VC website at www.askthevc.com. And no, the VentureDeals.com domain wasn't very expensive. VentureDeals.com started out several years ago as a question and answer site that we managed. We've recently added a new section called Resources, where the listener can find many standard forms of documents that are used in venture financings. They include the term sheet, as well as all of the documents that are generated from the term sheet as part of a venture financing. We have provided the standard forms that we use at Foundry Group. Yes, you can use these if we ever finance your company. We also included links for the most popular standard documents that are used in the industry today, along with commentary about some of the advantages and disadvantages of using them. If you use our book in an online course or at a university, you will now find an extensive teaching section on the website, along with several example syllabi. As we complete the fourth edition of this book, we humbly appreciate all the support we have received and people we have met through our writing. Thank you all very much for allowing us to do what we do. Jason Mendelson and Brad Feld, May 2019. Introduction: The Art of the term sheet. One of the first famous venture capital investments was Digital Equipment Corporation, DEC. In 1957, American Research and Development Corporation, AR&D, one of the first venture capital firms, invested $70,000 in DEC. When DEC went public in 1968, this investment was worth over $355 million, or a return of over 5,000 times the invested capital. AR&D's investment in DEC was one of the original venture capital home runs. In 1957, the venture capital industry was just being created. At the time, the investor community in the United States was uninterested in investing in computer companies, as the last wave of computer-related startups had performed poorly, and even large companies were having difficulty making money in the computer business. We can envision the frustration of DEC's co-founders, Ken Olson and Harlan Anderson, as the investors they talked to rejected them and their fledgling idea for a business. We can also imagine their joy when George Dorio, the founder of American Research and Development Corporation, offered to fund them. After a number of conversations and meetings, Dorio sent Olson and Anderson a letter expressing his interest in investing, along with his proposed terms. Today, this document is called the term sheet. Now imagine what that term sheet looked like. There are three different possibilities. The first is that it was a typed one-page letter that said, "We would like to invest $70,000 in your company and buy 78% of it." The next is that it was two pages of legal terms that basically said, "We would like to invest $70,000 in your company and buy 78% of it." Or it could have been an eight-paged type document that had all kinds of protective provisions, vesting arrangements, drag-along rights, and Securities and Exchange Commission, SEC, registration rights. Our guess is that it was not the third option. Over the past 50 years, the art of the term sheet has evolved and expanded, reaching its current eight or so page literary masterpiece. These eight pages contain a lot more than, "We'd like to invest X dollars in your company and get Y percent of it," but as you'll learn, there really are only two key things that matter in the actual term sheet negotiation: economics and control. In DEC's case, by owning 78% of the company, AR&D effectively had control of the company, and the price was clearly defined. $70,000 bought 78% of the company, resulting in a $90,000 post-money valuation. Today's venture capital investments have many more nuances. Individual venture capitalists, VCs, usually end up owning less than 50% of the company, so they don't have effective voting control, but often negotiate provisions that give them control over major decisions by the company. Many companies end up with multiple VCs who invest in the company at different points in time, resulting in different ownership percentages, varying rights, and diverging motivations. Founders don't always stay with the company through the exit, and in some cases, they end up leaving relatively early in the life of a company for a variety of reasons. Companies fail, and venture capitalists have gotten much more focused on protecting themselves for the downside as well as participating in the upside. Governance issues are always complex, especially when you have a lot of people sitting around the negotiation table. While it would be desirable to do venture capital deals with a simple agreement on price, a handshake, and a short legal agreement, this rarely happens. And while there have been plenty of attempts to standardize the term sheet over the years, the proliferation of lawyers, venture capitalists, and entrepreneurs, along with a steadily increasing number of investments, has prevented this from happening. Ironically, the actual definitive documents have become more standard over time. Whether it is the internet age that has spread information across the ecosystem, or clients growing tired of paying legal bills, there are more similarities in the documents today than ever before. As a result, we can lend you our experience in how venture financings are usually done. The good news is once you've negotiated the term sheet, you are done with the hard part. As a result, that's where we are going to focus our energy in this book. Throughout this book, we will cover not only the what and how of venture capital financings, but also why things work as they do. Let's begin our exploration by discussing the various players involved. Chapter 1. The Players. While it might seem like there are only two players in the financing dance, the entrepreneur and the venture capitalist, there are often others, including angel investors, lawyers, accountants, and mentors. Any entrepreneur who has created a company that has gone through multiple financings knows that the number of people involved can quickly spiral out of control. This is especially true if you aren't sure who is actually making the decisions at each step along the way. The experience, motivation, and relative power of each participant in a financing can be complex, and the implications are often mysterious. Let's begin our journey to understanding venture capital financings by making sure we understand each player and the dynamics surrounding the participants. The entrepreneur. Not all investors, bankers, and lawyers realize it, but the entrepreneur is the center of the entrepreneurial universe. Without entrepreneurs, there would be no term sheets and no startup ecosystem. Throughout this book, we use the terms entrepreneur and founder interchangeably. While some companies have only one founder, many have two, three, or even more. Sometimes these co-founders are equals. Other times, they aren't. Regardless of the number, they each have a key role in the formation of the company and any financing that occurs. The founders can't and shouldn't outsource their involvement in a financing to their lawyers. There are many issues in a financing negotiation that only the entrepreneurs can resolve. Even if you hire a fantastic lawyer who knows everything, don't forget that if your lawyer and your future investors don't get along, you will have larger issues to deal with, since the way your lawyer represents themselves will directly reflect on you. If you are the entrepreneur, make sure you direct and control the process. The relationship between co-founders at the beginning of the life of a company is almost always good. If it's not, the term sheet and corresponding financing are probably the least of the founders' worries. However, as time passes, the relationship between co-founders often frays. This could be due to many different factors: the stress of the business, competence, personality, or even changing life priorities, like a new spouse or children. When this happens, one or more founders will often leave the business. This can happen on good terms or not, and experienced investors know that it's best to anticipate these kinds of issues up front and will try to structure terms that predefine how things will work in these situations. The investors are often trying to protect the founders from each other by making sure things can be cleanly resolved without disrupting the company more than the departure of a founder already does. We cover this dynamic in terms like vesting, drag-along rights, and co-sale rights. When we do, we discuss both the investor perspective and the entrepreneur perspective. You'll see throughout the book that we've walked in both the investor's and the entrepreneur's shoes, and we try hard to take a balanced approach to our commentary. We have witnessed a lot of bad behavior on both sides of the table, and we'll try to be clear about these difficult issues. The venture capitalist. The venture capitalist, VC, is the next character in the term sheet play. VCs come in many shapes, sizes, and experience levels. While most, but not all, profess to be entrepreneur-friendly, many fall far short of their aspirations in marketing campaigns. The first sign of this often appears during the term sheet negotiation. Venture capital firms have their own hierarchies that are important for an entrepreneur to understand. Later in the book, we'll dive into all the deep, dark secrets about how VCs are motivated, how they are paid, and what their incentives can be. For now, we'll consider VCs as humans and talk about the people. The most senior person in the firm is usually called a managing director, MD, or a general partner, GP. In some cases, these titles have an additional prefix, such as executive managing director or founding general partner, to signify even more seniority over the other managing directors or general partners. These VCs make the final investment decisions and sit on the boards of directors of the companies they invest in. Partners can be, but often are not, what their title says they are. Many VCs these days carry business cards with a partner title, but are not actually partners in the firm. Instead, they are often junior deal professionals, also referred to as principals or directors, or are involved in specific aspects of the investing process, such as deal sourcing or due diligence. In some firms, which are described as full-stack VC firms, these partners help companies across a variety of dimensions, including recruiting, operations, technology, sales, and marketing, but are not decision-makers in the investment process. Some firms give everyone a partner title regardless of whether they have decision-making authority. This is an old investment banking trick, where everyone is at least a vice president, to try to blur the lines between GPs and non-GPs so that entrepreneurs don't really know the seniority level of the person they are interacting with. In the case of our firm, Foundry Group, we got tired of the pomp and circumstance of the MD and GP designations and now simply call each of the decision makers partner. Clear as mud? Good. As a founder, you should do your own due diligence into whom you are speaking to at any given firm. Figure out if the people you are spending time with have the authority to actually get your company the investment you are seeking. And while we generally use the term managing director and general partner throughout this book as the most senior partners in a firm, understand that their titles in real life could be as simple as partner, or not. Principals or directors are usually next in line. These are junior deal professionals working their way up the ladder to managing director. Principals usually have some deal responsibility, but they almost always require support from a managing director to move a deal through the VC firm. While a principal has some power, she probably can't make a final decision. Associates are typically not deal partners, those who can lead an investment process inside a venture fund and effectively get a company funded. Instead, associates work directly for one or more deal partners, usually a managing director. Associates do a wide variety of things, including scouting for new deals, helping with due diligence on existing deals, and writing up endless internal memos about prospective investments. They are also likely to be the person in the firm who spends the most time with the capitalization table, also known as a cap table, which is the spreadsheet that defines the economics of the deal. Many firms have an associate program, usually lasting 2 years, after which time the associate leaves the firm to work for a portfolio company, attend business school, or start their own company. Occasionally, star associates become principals. Analysts are at the bottom of the ladder. These are very junior people, usually recently graduated from college, who sit in a room with no windows down the hall from everyone else, crunch numbers, and write memos. In some firms, analysts and associates play similar roles and have similar functions. In others, the associates are more deal-centric. Regardless, analysts are generally smart people who are usually very limited in power and responsibility. Some firms, especially larger ones, have a variety of venture partners or operating partners. These are usually experienced entrepreneurs who have a part-time relationship with the VC firm. While they have the ability to advocate for a deal, they often need explicit support of one of the MDs, just as a principal would, in order to get a deal done. In some firms, operating partners don't sponsor deals, but take an active role in managing the investment as a chairman or board member. Entrepreneurs in residence, EIRs, are another type of part-time member of the VC firm. EIRs are experienced entrepreneurs who park themselves at a VC firm, usually for up to a year, while they are working on figuring out their next company. They often help the VC with introductions, due diligence, and networking during the period that they are an EIR. Some VCs pay their EIRs. Others simply provide them with free office space and an implicit agreement to invest in their next company. In smaller firms, you might be dealing with only MDs. For example, in our firm, Foundry Group, we have a total of 6 partners, previously called managing directors, each of whom has the same responsibility, authority, and power. In larger firms, you'll be dealing with a wide array of MDs, principals, associates, analysts, venture partners, operating partners, EIRs, and other titles. Since we wrote the first edition of this book in 2011, there has been a huge amount of title inflation among VC firms. A person who was called an associate back then might now be referred to as a partner. Entrepreneurs should do their research on the firms they are negotiating with in order to understand who they are talking to, what decision-making power that person has, and what process they have to go through to get an investment approved. The best source for this kind of information is other entrepreneurs who have worked with the VC firm in the past, although you'd also be surprised how much of this you can piece together just by looking at how the VC firm presents itself on its website. If all else fails, you can always ask the VC how things work, although the further down the hierarchy of the firm the person is, the less likely you are to get completely accurate information. The entrepreneur's perspective. Managing directors or general partners have the mojo inside venture capital firms. If you have anyone else prospecting you or working on the deal with you, associate, senior associate, principal, venture partner, or EIR, treat her with an enormous amount of respect, but insist on developing a direct relationship with an MD or a GP as well. Anyone other than an MD or a GP is unlikely to be at the firm for the long haul. The MDs and GPs are the ones who matter and who will make decisions about your company. Financing round nomenclature. Aside from the humans who work at a venture firm, there are also different types of venture firms. Understanding the different types of firms will help you target the right ones as you go fundraising. Most firms define themselves by the stage of financing they invest in. You've probably heard of different letters associated with financing rounds: Series A, Series B, Series B Prime, Series G, Series Seed, and even Series Pre-Seed. You'll hear about Series B2 rounds and Series D3 rounds. Venture capital is defined by constantly changing funding cycles. What is hot today may not be hot tomorrow. As the market changes, you'll hear about things like the Series A crunch or the Series B crunch, or even the notion that the Series A is the new Series B. What does all this mean? Since many things around entrepreneurship are dynamic, do a Google search, or Bing if you really insist. Recognize simply that as times change, the nomenclature does also. There is no magic or legal definition in naming rounds. We'd prefer to name them after different hiking trails in Boulder, but we'd confuse too many people, so we stick to letters. It used to be that the Series A round was the first financing, the Series B was the next round, and the Series C was the next round. After the Series C often came the Series D. You get the picture. At some point, investors who were making very early-stage investments, also referred to as seed rounds, decided that there must be a letter before A. Since there is no letter before A, people started to call those deals Series Seed. While we have always felt it was perfectly reasonable to call these seed rounds a Series A, this emerged around the time that there was a new wave of VC firms making seed investments. At the same time, Many of the firms who previously considered themselves Series A or first-round investors were letting these new firms make the first investments. The other firms still liked to refer to themselves as early-stage investors, so the old Series A became the Series Seed, and the old Series B started to be called Series A. Today, you'll even hear of a pre-seed round, which is simply an effort to label an earlier round that occurs before the seed round. Note also that companies don't want to have letters for financing rounds that extend too far into the alphabet. When you are doing your Series K round, the first thing a VC wonders is, what is wrong with you? Since an increasing number of rounds inherit the same terms, but with a different price from the preceding round, numerical round extensions appeared. When the same investors who invested $10 million in a Series B added on another $5 million to the company on the same terms, but at a different price, this became the Series B1. If another $5 million was invested in the company on the same terms, and again at a different price, this became the Series B2. When a new investor led the next $22 million financing, this finally became the Series C instead of the Series E, which is what it would have been if the B1 was the C round and the B2 was the D round. While the labeling of rounds can be complicated, what is important is that there is a language to discuss how early or late stage a company is. This is important when determining what VC might be right for it. Generally, pre-seed, seed, and Series A are early stage companies. Series B, C, and D are mid-stage companies, and Series E, or later, is a late-stage company. That said, the lines are often blurry. Types of venture capital firms. Now that we've got the nomenclature of rounds down, we can talk about which types of firms invest in which rounds. A micro VC fund is a small venture firm that often has only one general partner. Many of these folks started out as angel investors, which we will talk about in the next section, and after some success, created a fund to invest other people's money alongside their own. Sizes of these funds can vary, but are usually less than $15 million in total capital per fund. These firms almost exclusively invest at the seed and early stage, often alongside other micro VC firms, angel investors, and friends and family investors. Seed stage funds are generally bigger than a micro VC fund and can scale up to $150 million per fund. Seed funds focus on being the first institutional money into a company and rarely invest in later rounds past a Series A. Seed stage firms often provide your first non-company board member, so be thoughtful as this relationship goes well beyond just the investment. Next up are the early stage funds. These are the funds that are generally $100 to $300 million in size and invest in seed stage and Series A companies, but occasionally lead a Series B round. These firms also often continue to invest later in the life of a company, often taking their pro rata in subsequent rounds, which we'll explain later in this book. Mid-stage funds are those that generally invest in Series B and later rounds. The funds are often called growth investors, as their first investment in a company is at a point where a company is clearly working, but now needs capital to accelerate or continue its growth. These funds usually range from $200 million to $1 billion in size. Late-stage funds enter the picture when the company is now a successful and standalone business, typically doing its last financing before a prospective initial public offering, IPO. These include specific late-stage VC funds, but also can be hedge funds, crossover investors that invest primarily in the public markets, funds associated with large banks, or sovereign wealth funds. Like all things in the VC world, you can't categorize each firm tightly. Some firms with billion-dollar funds have early-stage programs that invest in young companies. Some firms have multiple funds that invest in different stages of a company. At Foundry Group, we have traditionally raised early-stage funds that invested in the early stages, seed, A, and occasionally B, and separate later-stage funds that invested in growth rounds, similar to what a mid-stage firm would do. These days, we raise just one fund that invests across each of these stages. Some firms have dedicated programs or partners for different investment stages, while others invest along the company life cycle with no special delineations. A few, like ours, have all the partners work on everything together. It's essential to make sure that you are targeting the types of firms that invest in your stage of company. One of the most common mistakes entrepreneurs make is focusing on firms that are irrelevant for them at their current stage. Try to avoid the common mistake of putting energy into raising money from a firm that doesn't invest in companies at your stage of growth. The angel investor. In addition to VCs, your investor group may include individual investors, usually referred to as angel investors, or angels for short. These angels are often a key source of seed and early stage investment and are very active in the first round of investment. Angels can be professional investors, successful entrepreneurs, friends, or family members. Many VCs are very comfortable investing alongside angels and often encourage their active involvement early in the life of a company. As a result, the angels are an important part of any financing dance. However, not all angels are created equal, nor do all VCs share the same view of angels. While angels will invest at various points in time, they usually invest in the early rounds and often don't participate in future rounds. In cases where everything is going well, this is rarely an issue. However, if the company hits some speed bumps and has a difficult financing, the angels' participation in future rounds may come into question. Some of the terms we discuss in the book, such as pay-to-play and drag-along rights, are specifically designed to help the VCs force a certain type of behavior on the angels and other VC investors in these difficult financing rounds. While angel investors are usually high net worth individuals, they aren't always. There are specific Securities and Exchange Commission, SEC, rules around accredited investors, and you should make sure that each of your angel investors qualifies as an accredited investor or has an appropriate exemption. This has become more complicated with the passage of the Jobs Act in 2012, which we discuss further in Chapter 10, Crowdfunding. The best way to ensure you are following the rules correctly is to ask your lawyer for help. Some angel investors make a lot of small investments. These very active or promiscuous angels are called super angels. These super angels are often experienced entrepreneurs who have had one or more exits and have decided to invest their own money in new startups. In most cases, super angels are well known in entrepreneurial circles and are often a huge help to early-stage companies. As super angels make more investments, they often decide to raise capital from their friends, other entrepreneurs, or institutions. At this point, the super angel raises a fund similar to a VC fund and becomes a micro VC. While these micro VCs often want to be thought of as angels instead of VCs, once they've raised money from other people, they have the same fiduciary responsibility to their investors that a VC has, and as a result, they are really just VCs. It's important to remember that just like founders and VCs, there isn't the generic angel investor archetype. Lumping them together and referring to them as a single group can be dangerous. Never assume any of these people are like one another. They will all have their own incentives, pressures, experiences, and sophistication levels. Their individual characteristics will often define your working relationship with them well beyond any terms that you negotiate. The entrepreneur's perspective. Don't put yourself in a position where you can be held hostage by angels. They are important, but they are rarely in a position to determine the company's direction. If your angel group is a small, diffuse list of friends and family, consider setting up a special purpose limited partnership controlled by one of them as a vehicle for them to invest. Chasing down 75 signatures when you want to do a financing or sell the company is not fun. Also, true friends and family need special care. Make sure they understand up front that, one, they should think of their investment as a lottery ticket, and two, every holiday or birthday party is not an investor relations meeting. The syndicate. While some VCs invest alone, many invest with other VCs. A collection of investors is called a syndicate. When VCs refer to the syndicate, they are often talking about the major participants in the financing round, who are usually, but not always, VCs. The syndicate includes any investor, whether a VC, angel, super angel, strategic investor, corporation, law firm, or anyone else that ends up purchasing equity in a financing. Most syndicates have a lead investor, who is typically one of the VC investors. Two VCs will often co-lead a syndicate, and occasionally you'll see three co-leads. While there is nothing magical about who the lead investor is, having one often makes it easier for the entrepreneurs to focus their energy around the negotiation. Rather than having one-off negotiations with each investor, the lead in the syndicate will often take the role of negotiating terms for the entire syndicate. Regardless of the lead investor or the structure of the syndicate, it is the entrepreneur's responsibility to make sure they are communicating with each of the investors in the syndicate. Although the lead investor may help corral the other investors through the process, don't assume that you don't need to communicate with each of the investors. You do. Be careful of too many cooks in the kitchen. In the past few years, the idea of a party round, where many investors make relatively small investments at the early stage, has become popular. It isn't unusual to see a $2 million seed round with 10 VCs and 20 angel investors in the round. While it might seem nice to have all these fancy names in a press release, the entrepreneurs get very little attention from any of the investors since their investments were all tiny relative to what the VCs normally invest. As companies raise their next round, they realize they have the worst of all possible worlds, which is having a lot of VCs as investors, but none who are committed in a meaningful way. The entrepreneur's perspective. While you should communicate with all investors, you should insist that investors agree, at least verbally, that the lead investor can speak for the whole syndicate when it comes to investment terms. You should not let yourself be in a position where you have to negotiate the same deal multiple times. If there is dissension in the ranks, ask the lead investor for help. The lawyer. Ah, the lawyers. I'll bet you thought we'd never get to them. In deals, a great lawyer can be a huge help, and a bad lawyer can be a disaster. For the entrepreneur, an experienced lawyer who understands VC financings is invaluable. VCs make investments all the time, while entrepreneurs raise money occasionally. Even an experienced entrepreneur runs the risk of getting hung up on a nuance that a VC has thought through many times. In addition to helping negotiate, a great lawyer can focus the entrepreneur on what really matters. While this book will cover all the terms that typically come up in a VC financing, we'll repeat a simple mantra that the only real terms that matter are economics and control. Yes, annoying VCs will inevitably spend time negotiating unimportant terms, even though the chance these terms will ever matter is very slight. This is just life in a negotiation where there are always endless tussles over unimportant points, sometimes due to silly reasons, but they are often used as a negotiating strategy to distract you from the main show. VCs are experts at this. A great lawyer can keep you from falling into these traps. A bad lawyer, or one inexperienced in VC financings, can do you a world of harm. In addition to getting out-negotiated, the inexperienced lawyer will focus on the wrong issues, fight hard on things that don't matter, and run up the bill on both sides. Whenever entrepreneurs want to use their cousin who is a divorce lawyer, we take an aggressive position before we start negotiating that the entrepreneur needs a lawyer who has a clue. Never forget that your lawyer is a reflection on you. Your reputation in the startup ecosystem is important, and a bad or inexperienced lawyer will tarnish it. Furthermore, once the deal is done, you'll be partners with your investors, so you don't want a bad or inexperienced lawyer creating unnecessary tension in the financing negotiation that will carry over once you are partners with your investors. If you are a lawyer, think twice before you act unreasonably toward a future board member of the company you represent. While you are responsible to the company in the current negotiation, the investor you are negotiating with will be a future owner in the company. Be thoughtful and play a multi-turn game, as it is likely that the company's future investor will know other lawyers whom they are comfortable with and may push to make a switch post-financing if they think you are an irrational or unhelpful negotiator. The entrepreneur's perspective. At the same time that you don't want an inexperienced lawyer creating unnecessary tension in the negotiation, don't let a VC talk you out of using your lawyer of choice just because that lawyer isn't from a nationally known firm or the lawyer rubs the VC the wrong way. This is your lawyer, not your VC's lawyer. That said, to do this well, you need to be close enough to the communication to make sure your lawyer is being reasonable and communicating clearly and in a friendly manner. While lawyers usually bill by the hour, many lawyers experienced with VC investments will cap their fees in advance of the deal. As of this writing in 2019, a very early-stage financing can be done for between $5,000 and $20,000, and a typical financing can be completed for between $20,000 and $40,000. Lawyers in large cities tend to charge more, and if your company has any items to clean up from your past, your costs will increase. If your lawyers and the VC's lawyers don't get along, your bill can skyrocket if you don't stay involved in the process. If the lawyers are unwilling to agree to a modest fee cap, you should question whether they know what they are doing. Interestingly, these numbers are virtually unchanged from a decade ago, while billable rates have more than doubled in the same time. While some document standardization has occurred, the average lawyer spends less time per deal than in ancient times, the 1990s. Ultimately, the entrepreneur must take responsibility for the final results. The entrepreneur's perspective. Don't be shy about insisting that your lawyer cap their fee at a modest number, or even that the lawyer will only get paid out of the proceeds of a deal. There's no reason, if you are a solid entrepreneur with a good business, that even a top-tier law firm won't take your unpaid deal to its executive committee as a flyer to be paid on closing. The accountant. In early-stage financings, accountants are rarely seen unless there are cross-border issues, or the company is restructuring from an LLC or other pass-through tax entity to a C corporation. However, if you have any concerns about tax treatment resulting from a financing, engage an accountant to assist your lawyer. As companies raise money in later rounds, accounting issues surrounding stock option pricing, tax filings, and tax credits become more prevalent. While the traditional approach was to use a Big Eight accounting firm, which are now the Big Four, we encourage you to explore mid-size and smaller local firms who are used to working with startups. The banker. Investment bankers are rarely seen in early-stage financings, but can be the ones running the show on behalf of the company for later rounds that raise $50 million or more of capital. We are always perplexed when we receive a funding inquiry from an investment banker representing an early-stage company. We know that the banker is going to charge the company a substantial amount of its funding capital to do the work. Many angels and early-stage VCs don't respond well to bankers in early rounds. Most importantly, we wonder why the entrepreneur didn't just contact us directly. We have generally observed that if an early-stage company has hired a banker to help with fundraising, Either it has been unsuccessful in its attempt to raise money and is hoping the banker can help it in a last-ditch effort, or it is getting bad advice from its advisors. Either way, most of the early-stage inquiries we get from investment bankers end up being filed in the circular file. There is a role for a banker in a later-stage financing, especially one aimed at strategic or non-traditional investors. Bankers can be especially useful for deals that include a partial recapitalization by a financial sponsor, such as a private equity firm. The mentor. Every entrepreneur should have a stable of experienced mentors. These mentors can be hugely useful in any financing, especially if they know the VCs involved. We like to refer to these folks as mentors instead of advisors, since the term advisor often implies that there is some sort of fee agreement with the company. It's unusual for a company, especially an early stage one, to have a fee arrangement with an advisor around a financing. Nonetheless, there are advisors who prey on entrepreneurs by showing up, offering to help raise money, and then asking for compensation by taking a cut of the deal. There are even some bold advisors who ask for a retainer relationship to help out. We encourage early-stage entrepreneurs to stay away from these advisors. In contrast, mentors help the entrepreneurs, especially early-stage ones, because someone once helped them. Many mentors end up being early angel investors in companies or get a small equity grant for serving on the board of directors or board of advisors, but they rarely ask for anything up front. While having mentors is never required, we strongly encourage entrepreneurs to find them, work with them, and build long-term relationships with them. The benefits are enormous and often surprising. Most great mentors we know do it because they enjoy it. When this is the motivation, you often see some important and lasting relationships develop. The entrepreneur's perspective. Mentors are great. There's no reason not to give someone a small success fee if they truly help you raise money. Random email introductions to a VC they met once at a cocktail party don't count. Sometimes it will make sense to compensate mentors with options as long as you have some control over the vesting of the options based on your satisfaction with the mentor's performance as an ongoing advisor. Chapter 2. Preparing for fundraising. While it's tempting to jump right into fundraising, huge issues can be avoided simply by being a good boy or girl scout and being prepared. A capable lawyer who knows how to do venture deals is a key part of this. Our friends at Cooley LLP, where Jason was an associate 2 decades ago, were kind enough to provide some of the content to help us help you be prepared. Choosing the right lawyer. A startup's legal advisor is an integral partner who will guide a company through its corporate life cycle from incorporation to acquisition or initial public offering, IPO, and act as trusted advisor and connector to investors and other resources. In selecting an attorney, entrepreneurs have a variety of options to choose from, ranging from solo practitioners to multinational firms. Evaluating these options to find the right fit requires a management team to expend time and energy. This upfront investment can ensure the company avoids common legal pitfalls that can derail startups. When evaluating candidates for corporate counsel, entrepreneurs should consider a short list of factors, including experience level, cost, and comfort with an attorney's communication style. For early-stage companies, partnering with an attorney or law firm with a proven track record of representing startups can be especially valuable since experienced startup attorneys have an appreciation for the types of legal hurdles emerging companies may face. In addition, they are often well connected to early-stage investors, accelerators, and other resources that are critical to a startup's success. We highly recommend that you find a lawyer with whom you have a personal connection. Your most intimate business details will be shared with the person and firm that you choose, and you deserve an attorney whom you trust completely and with whom you enjoy working. In addition, whoever represents you will impact your reputation because they will be a representative of your company. Do your research, get references from trusted advisors, friends, and colleagues, and spend time with your prospective lawyer before making a choice. Although it's natural and appropriate to focus on cost, don't obsess on the hourly rate. While the bill you receive is made up of the hourly rate times the hours spent, the efficiency of a lawyer is always the biggest factor in a bill. A competent lawyer who knows her way around startups is worth much more than someone who specializes in estate planning but charges half the rate per hour. Proactive versus reactive. The cliche, "the best defense is a good offense," is as relevant for a company preparing for a venture financing as for a sports team on its way to a championship game. Any entrepreneur who has lived through pitching, negotiating, and closing a venture round can confirm that navigating a venture financing is a demanding process that involves unexpected challenges. There are several proactive...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.